Well, hello, Dr. Mehrotra.
Hi, how are you, Anika?
I'm good. I've had a crazy week. My kids are, I don't know whether they have cough and cold or allergies, and it looks like my dog has allergies too. So, you know, obviously it's allergy season. But other than that, I'm good. I guess it's our second time back in the audience, in the studio.
Yes, and it's great to be back, and you hit it right on the head. It is bad allergy season, and I'm sure a lot of people are facing those symptoms and they just don't know what to do about it.
Yeah, I should tell you a really funny story, though it's got nothing to do with it. I don't know what the dogs come under integrative pediatrics, but I have to tell you the story with my English Springer Spaniel. I don't know where he picked up a couple of fleas from and I couldn't get rid of them. Somewhere online I read that rosemary extract water is great. So I boiled all the rosemary I could get in the house and I sprayed him for 10 days. Finally, my husband said, do you think now may be the right time to go to the doctor because none of your alternate medicines are working?
Well, I hope the veterinarian was also an integrative vet.
Well, he did look at me with a lot of sympathy, but he realized I need help.
So I'm sure everybody's listening here and trying to figure out what are we talking about. And why, so why don't you give them a little bit of an introduction?
Yes, so this is the second round of our conversation host show that we call In Conversation with Dr. Naveen Mehrotra, who is a very, very famous pediatrician in the neighborhood. I'm saying this because he will not introduce himself like this. And my name is Anika, and my claim to fame is that I'm a mother of two kids, not including the dog I was mentioning. I have a son and I have a daughter, and that makes me, of course, an expert on the parenthood subject. And we started this because, if you missed our first introduction show, we started this because we feel there is a need to have a conversation about something called integrative pediatrics, integrative medicine. And pediatrics because, you know, children are so susceptible to diseases and to, you know, various things in the environment that we thought would be a great way to start the conversation.
The theme behind it is to try to get the best of allopathic medicine as well as the best of non-traditional medications and trying to bring that together to give the parents a little bit better idea. I know in our community, in the South Asian community, a lot of us really first go to alternative therapies. And some of the main alternative therapies that we come across or we first go to is obviously Ayurveda or homeopathy. Some of the other common ones that are out there are naturopathy and, aromapathy.
Acupuncture, Chinese medicine.
Right. So there's a lot of different alternative types of treatments out there which parents really don't know how to navigate the system.
Yes.
And they're a little scared about talking to it with their mainstream provider.
Yes.
So unless they are comfortable with their physician, they may not talk about it. And some of those medications or treatment strategies that they're using may actually not interact well with the allopathic medicine. Or if allopathic medicine doesn't have some sort of treatment for a certain illness, then the alternative medicine can kick in. So the aim of the show is to try to bring those thoughts together and really hear from our audience as well about what they think works and what doesn't work, and are they comfortable talking to their provider about it? Because I think the
provider, because I know you're talking doctor speak, you mean your doctor, right?
Yes, your doctor, because someone may not go to a doctor, they may go to another different healthcare provider, as I would use that term.
We have to get some definitions right? And before that, our number, of course, that you can call is 732-297-9886. Again, that number is 732-297-9886. Of course, if you're used to calling into EBC Radio, you'd probably be familiar with that number. Coming back to the provider question. So if I go and ask my pharmacist a question, is he being my provider?
He is, if you are actually taking that advice and following through with it.
Okay.
So he's acting as your provider.
Yeah.
So I guess I'll throw this out for the audience. How many of you actually feel comfortable telling your doctor what other types of medications or treatment strategies are you using? So please call in. I'd love to hear how many of them are comfortable with their doctor.
Yes.
Because that's the first step.
Yes.
In this.
Yes. And if you're not discussing it, why aren't you discussing it, right? We also have an entire community built around this. We have a website, mywholechild.org. We have a Facebook
community. And we also have a Facebook community where people can come on and post and discuss amongst themselves what works, what doesn't work. And obviously, we're going to be talking a little bit about allergies today, so we'll open that up for people as well.
Yeah.
And I see Kulji sneezing there.
You know, I just started to, you know, I mean, and I think most of us, we suffer from allergies and it's really bad.
So, Kulji, what do you do for allergies?
Well, you know, to be honest with you, you know, somebody tells you, take some garlic and put some cinnamon and do this and put some honey, nothing works. You need to take that spray or, you know.
So you're a Zyrtec fan, huh?
Yes, and you have to, you know, see if you don't take early enough,
yeah,
it gets worse.
Yeah,
it gets and I think
worse.
I want to know from doctor that, you know, people who ignore it, they really suffer a lot.
Yeah.
And there's no way, there's no quick fix.
Right. Yeah.
Right. So allergies, we always say, is more of a phenomena on the Western world as opposed to the Eastern, where we come from. So people will say, okay, no, it's not something that we deal with in our country. So it's something that we are creating as a problem. So allergies are very common. A lot of people suffer from it. And there are many different forms of allergies. So allergies can be just limited to the skin. You might get rashes. Allergies can give you nasal symptoms, so you can have sneezing. You can have respiratory symptoms. You can be coughing. You can have severe, what we call anaphylaxis. So if you eat something, your actually body can collapse and you can die from it. So there are many different types of allergies.
And they make you feel from miserable to more miserable to even more miserable to most miserable till you might actually have shock. That's awesome.
That is so true. So now you can either take the allopathic side and you can go ahead and start to treat with your branded medications that you just threw out that name, which we'll not say.
Sorry. Did you mean Zyrtec? Oh, I'm so sorry. I will not mention that again.
Or loratadine, which is commonly known as Claritin or Allegra,
yeah,
and so on. So there are a lot of different medications on the allopathic side that you may take for allergies, but one medication may not be enough. You may have to take along with it a nasal spray,
yeah,
or you might have to take other medications.
Yeah.
But if that doesn't work, or if somebody's not willing to try that, then what do they do? Can they will say, okay, haldi le lo, and maybe, you know, is cheez ka pani le lo, or, you know, take this herb or that herb.
Yeah.
And we'd love to hear what people are trying and what has worked for them. So you can call in at 732-297-9886.
So obviously one of the reasons why this is not a typical talk show and it's more like a conversation is because I am here to debate with you on this subject, so which is why we would love to hear from people and really look at some alternate points of view out there. What has worked, what hasn't worked, when do you decide when something is not working and take on an alternate option. Dr. Marotha, before we actually discuss something on allergies, I thought maybe as you know, as our second show, we could probably touch upon a few of the alternate kinds of medicines and where it would really come from. You know, I know as Indians, we're most familiar with Ayurveda. You know, there's a book on the subject, you know, it's XYZ, 1,000 years old. Just a little bit of conversation on each of them.
So Ayurveda is sort of a concept that I think being Indian, you grow up with. So it is a part of your life.
Yeah.
It focuses a lot about the three different types of doshas that you might have.
Yeah.
You know, people may or may not know what type of dosha they have, which is kapha, vata,
yes,
and pitta.
Pitta.
So, you know, if you go to an Ayurvedic physician, they'll tell you what type of dosha you have. And if there is an imbalance on the dosha, then that can manifest as an illness.
Yeah.
So the treatment at that point then becomes to try to bring your, if your one of your doshas is out of whack, then you try to bring it back,
yes,
to that. So
To balance. Yes,
right.
Yes.
And that is how Ayurveda would work.
Yeah.
But obviously, I'm not an Ayurvedic physician, so that's not my expertise. So if I think that Ayurveda might work for you, I would go ahead and refer you out to an Ayurvedic physician,
yes,
and work with them in terms of trying to get the best in the treatment strategy for you.
Right. But obviously, Dr. Marotha, you may not be well-versed with it, but there's hope for you. Use the word back in your conversation. Oh my God. Suddenly, the coolness level of the show has gone up. So that's Ayurveda, and obviously, it's something that we all know. Whether we may know the definition of it or not, it's something that touches us, right? Whether it is turmeric or whether it is your little things like herbs, it's something that touches our daily life. Homeopathy, again, I think is something that we use as Asians a lot. I don't know whether people know that it was actually founded by a German physician. And so I was wondering if you can shed some more light on that.
Well, even before we go to homeopathy, yeah. I think one of the most common things with Ayurveda is the type of food,
yeah.
right? So what food can you eat, what can you not eat? So when a child comes in with allergies and sneezing and coughing,
yeah.
the first question I get is, oh, doc, can he have bananas? Can he
yeah.
have cold stuff? Or
yeah.
can he have this?
Yeah.
So this is an inherent concept that we have grown up with.
Yeah.
So we need to understand that. And if it's a provider that you're not, or let me say, if it's a doctor you're not comfortable with.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm thinking of the word provider, I'm thinking, well, you know, my car service guy is a provider. He provides me with a clean car.
I was just having another conversation with somebody else, and they said they hate the term provider because it makes you sound like you're somebody who's doing
service.
Doing
a commercial service.
Right.
Yeah.
But that is, unfortunately, what the insurance industry has branded us with.
Dr. Mehrotra, if you can be doctor for this session. But you're absolutely right. You're talking about food and Ayurveda and, you know.
Right. So, you know, they'll ask you if they can have bananas or if they can have rice with
yeah.
when the kid has a cold.
Does that make you sound like, the first time you heard these, did you feel strange? You studied here, you studied in the Western medicine concept, right? I am assuming that doctors over here are not taught alternative medicine as part of their course. Are you taught alternative medicine as part of course?
No, of course not. So,
I
was comfortable with it because that's an inherent part of mine growing up.
Okay.
So it's part of my culture.
But most doctors, especially pediatricians, would not, right?
Would not be.
So if I went to somebody who is not familiar with this and said, well, you know, can my son eat rice because he has a cough, they might look at me funny, right?
Let
me
of course.
It's not a conversation
course.
You expect.
The thing is that there are a lot of different alternative therapies out there, and we're really not endorsing one or the other what works, or, you know, if it really is the thing that worked or not.
Yeah.
But it's something that you need to share with your physician so that they're aware what you're trying and what
yeah.
you're not trying.
Yeah.
And then what the scientific community or the physician community looks for are validated research.
Absolutely.
So if the research is out there and it promotes that, yes, that works,
yeah.
Then definitely. But I think the first step is trying to be comfortable enough with your doctor to let them know what actually you have done, and then the doctor can investigate if this is a strategy that works or not.
But I'm assuming that many times you're not going to tell your doctor because you don't want them to, like I said, look at you funnily and say, oh my God, I don't know what this person is doing. I mean, having said that, it's really very therapeutic to look at. You know, everything is a new flavor, right? Whether it's cocoa, whether it's Moroccan oil, or whether it is, you know, coconut oil right now is so huge in the Western world. Everyone is doing everything with coconut oil. It doesn't matter what the cholesterol levels are. But, you know, so it's almost like, oh, I love this. Let's make this the flavor of the day. And then everyone adapts it. And I think it looks like one of the philosophies of alternate medicine, which is where I think it's different from contemporary medicine, Western medicine, is that not everyone is the same. You know, you're being treated as an individual. Something is being tailor-made for you, which is something that you can't really do in Western medicine, right?
Right. So I think one of the main themes we want to leave with every
yeah.
week is that you should be comfortable enough with your doctor to tell them what
yeah.
you are
yeah.
what you are trying or what you're not trying.
And why are you trying
yeah. it, obviously.
Yeah. yeah.
And trying to come up with an integrative approach. And that's what this show is about.
Yeah.
It's not about alternative or traditional or
yes.
allopathic. It's
yes.
about integrating the best of both worlds.
Yes, find a solution.
So find a solution.
Yes.
So,
yes.
you know, obviously, as we started talking about Ayurveda, there's also homeopathy is very big in our community. So
yeah.
the first thing people might try is homeopathy.
For the longest time, I thought homeopathy was Indian.
But people yeah. didn't know is that it was actually originated by a German.
Yes.
So, and it's something that, you know, people will call up in India and give their symptoms, and
yeah.
some homeopath will go ahead and send them medication,
yeah.
and they
yeah.
go ahead and try it.
Yeah. So what is the ethos of homeopathy? I only remember some little white sugar things and something. There's something to it, right? How does it work?
So homeopathy believes that like treats like. So
I see. Okay.
Anything that causes an illness gets diluted multifold. So there is a very small trace amount of that substance, and you take that substance on a repeated basis, and that will
okay.
sort of create a response by your body, so your body can fight off the illness. It's kind
okay.
of, I guess, you can think about it similarly as a vaccine. So if you give
right,
yes. so if you give
yes.
a child a vaccine, you are sensitizing
yeah.
the child's body to be able to fight off an illness.
Yes.
So polio vaccine, you know, there's some particle that actually can raise the immune response
yeah.
so that your body will fight that off.
I see. Okay.
So that is what the inherent concept about homeopathy is. So you'll have these sugar-coated pills that have been drenched in this tincture or in
yes.
this liquid that
yes.
has an infinitesimal amount of something that's causing the illness.
Yeah.
And you take that and that causes your body to respond. So the scientific community may not believe in it.
Yeah.
Just because they feel that there is not enough literature out there to support that.
Right, right.
Okay. But I know our community uses it left and right.
Yes, it does. I remember when I was young, I had a fever, I believe, that just wouldn't break. And finally, my mother took me to some place and they gave me some homeopathic medicine. Even in my fever, I remember the sugar-coated pills tasted really good.
I think every household had that small pills, Aquanite 30.
Even after I was well, I was looking for sugar-coated pills. Life is better with sugar-coated pills.
My mom swears by Arnica. You know,
Arnica,
yes. chot lagti hai,
Arnica ka.
First thing she'll go is, main Arnica le rahi
hu. You mean not Anika, Arnica, right?
Not Anika.
Just to be clear. So that's so, homeopathy. Now, it's been around for a long time too, right? It's not something new and it's the, you know, is the rage of the decade or something, am I right?
No, no, it's been around for about a little over 100 years.
Wow.
And, you know, once again, it's been used and it's very, very common out there.
Okay.
So being a mainstream provider or right. a mainstream doctor, an allopathic doctor,
Dr. Maritha, we're going to now start finding you for every time you say provider. A dollar towards EBC radio.
So lost my train of thought.
No,
there you go.
No, a little over 100 years, and you said yeah.
Right, so a little over, but there are certain things that I do believe that yeah. homeopathy may actually help.
For example,
so we've seen this work in atopic dermatitis, meaning eczema,
okay. Okay.
in some cases of vitiligo,
yeah.
which you know patients of mine have gone and tried homeopathic medicine, and they've come back with some good results.
Oh, that's awesome.
So, you know, it's not my expertise once again, but
right.
I would refer them out to
somebody who is an expert on the subject.
Right.
And then what about, I mean, Chinese medicine sounds like Indian medicine, sounds like an ocean. So would acupuncture be part of Chinese medicine? Or?
Sure. The big one is the Chinese herbal medicine and acupuncture. So
yeah.
acupuncture, we haven't really started using a whole lot in kids.
Yeah.
I think people have associated that with pain relief, so you go in there, get all those
yeah,
needles done,
yeah, yeah.
And we can talk a little bit more about
it.
But there's some people who swear by it,
yeah.
so you know they have had relief.
Yeah.
So even if it's not been proven scientifically, if it works anecdotally, it doesn't harm the body,
yeah.
then why not try it?
Right.
Right?
So give us an example. You know, I know we have a few minutes left, and you know, I definitely want to continue the conversation on our Facebook page, you know, or get onto mywholechild.org. You know, give us a call on 732-819-8800. You know, let's get this conversation started. Every movement, I think, starts with a conversation. So we would love to do that. That's what we want to do. But I was wondering whether you could leave us with an example of how, in your practice, you saw recently, you know, you gave us an example last time as well, an example of where you saw integrative medicine work and really, really blossom the child, you know, and do well for everybody.
Right, and I don't want to give out concrete examples, but I'll give you a breadth of what
yeah.
we've used it for. You know, definitely for common colds, it's something that people use. You know, home remedies are now the first thing that we say, because
yeah.
FDA has pulled off a lot of those allopathic
yes.
cough and cold medications
yes.
that were
yes.
out there.
Yes. And why
so,
did that happen?
Well, there were a couple of reasons. One was that obviously it was causing harm.
Yes.
Side effects were a little bit more than what we actually wanted.
Right.
And parents were using them liberally, meaning very freely without really consulting with their doctor.
Overdosing.
And, right,
okay.
overdosing
okay.
and all of that.
Okay.
So those were pulled off the market.
Yeah.
And
for a long time.
Yeah, so
yeah.
even now, I mean, there's a lot of recalls that keep on happening, and
yeah.
it's very hard to keep up with them.
Correct.
So, you know, you come up with certain side effects, and then everything gets pulled off.
Yeah.
So, you know, that does happen. So I know for cough and colds, one of the common things that people will go ahead and use are home remedies. You know, your
so to Indians, I understand, it's very easy to say turmeric, honey. What about to Americans, you know, what would they do?
Yeah, so it's something that I would sort of, you know, coach them along with, because homeopathic medicine is now pretty readily available in most of the
okay.
supermarkets. So they actually come back and tell me, oh, doc, I took this or I took that for a cough and cold. So it's definitely out there. It's something we need to be aware of. It's something that we need to be a little bit more, know scientifically about as well.